quite well. I actually think Jackson County's been pretty skilled and fast, all things considered. And the state too, and the coordination seems to be pretty big. It's just overwhelming. And a few things I could talk about, bits and pieces here, but the real focus for a number of us is the challenge is not the next week, and it's not years from now. It's the challenge of housing people over the next 2 or 3 months. And there are a lot of ideas, a lot of strands to that. We are expecting substantial federal money to help. And that's a necessary but not sufficient condition in deploying, in getting this done in a timely way, you know, beginning with the massive task of debris removal, and which is more complicated because of toxic materials and all of that. It all feels daunting. But I'm hearing a lot of creative thinking about how to get people comfortably sheltered for the next few months. And that's kind of where my antennae are out. I'll be listening for any thoughts about that tonight. And really open to hearing from people what they believe states that needs are that the state might be able to provide. I think I'll leave it right there. There's plenty else to talk about, sort of a grab bag of stuff, planning for people to have access to voting by mail or elsewhere by in time, which is going well, I think, and number of things. I hope folks will at least use my office as a conduit if they're feeling friction in communications with the state or not getting responded to quickly. And, you know, we're all kind of figuring this out together.
Great. Thanks so much for that. And thanks for being on the call, Jeff.
Sure.
Let's see, we've got a question in already, which I think is a really important one to even start us off with, from Dave Wright. And I just want to let everybody know that I am recording this call. I've had several people say they couldn't make the call, but would really like to hear what people have to say. It's always nice if you can put on the video just so we can feel like we're really having a conversation. I get that a lot of people don't have the bandwidth to do that, but it's always great to see your faces. So if you can do that, that'd be wonderful. Jeff, would you like to respond to the question about housing?
Yeah, so there's a list of things, and we're not in a position to assess feasibility very well right now. One is massive procurement of used manufactured housing and recreational vehicles, and then a rapidly deployed development of hookups on any number of properties. We're not anticipating being able to use any of the destroyed mobile home parks anytime soon. We think there are too many issues with that. There is a private sector initiative getting pulled together around collecting and renovating shipping containers. And there's actually a company that does that. And at about $30,000 per unit, apparently you can have a pretty viable longish term shelter for people. You is getting really involved with the dorms that they were getting ready to demolish and their existing dorms. Those are a few straight out. You know, we had been in the process of trying to purchase motels for sequestered shelter for homeless people or underhoused people during COVID. So that's continuing. We're interested in all the motels we can find and probably have resources to get them. Those are four or five, none of which by themselves even starts to scale to the problem. But hopefully in a smart, integrated way, we can do some good.
Great, thanks. So people are starting to share resources on the chat, which is awesome. So feel free to keep doing that and to put your questions there. And Jim and I will try and make sure we capture those. But we wanted to have the opportunity for people to go around and talk about what their organization is doing and or what their organization needs or what you offer. So really asks and offers. And if you would like to chime in, given that there's a lot of people on this call, which is great, the button at the very bottom right of your screen has a reaction button. And if you put a hand up or a thumbs up, or there's probably a different place for the hand thing, which I can't find anymore. but if you just make some kind of an icon in your screen, we'll make sure that
participant, you participant, Cynthia.
Is it back in participants? Okay, great. Yep. Thanks.
You can raise
your hand. Go into participants and you can raise your hand. Actually, I don't think you can as a host.
No, not as a host.
Yeah, okay, great. So you all can find your little raised hand, but would really like to hear what you are, what you're doing. I think if you don't mind, Dave, I'll start off with you just because you and I have already had a bit of a conversation about this, but do you want to talk a little bit about what commercial property management is doing? And by the way, if there are ways that you see that you want help or want to invite collaboration with somebody else here, feel free to call that out as well. So.
Sure. Thanks, Cynthia. And thank you, Senator Golden. I think that was good to hear some of those options, because the immediate need is what I'm concerned about with people displaced and leaving our area because we can't find enough housing quickly for them. We had about 365 units in our portfolio, 4 mobile home parks, a 30-unit apartment building, a couple 8-plexes, houses, duplexes in Talent and Phoenix all burn to the ground. And so we're working hard just to help get resources to our residents, just of where they can go, what they can get as far as quick assistance. And we started a GoFundMe campaign just for our residents, because I was trying to figure out a way to get it directly to them that wasn't, through some of the other funds and that they might be a little hesitant to even go to, and I didn't know the process. So anyway, we put 10,000 in there, and then there's got another company that's going to do 5, and then once we get to 5, they're going to match it, I guess. So we're close to that, and just going to do what we can just to get a little immediate help to the residents right now. But I guess my bigger concern is, where are they going to go next week, and for a couple months, or till we have more long-term solutions for them. So.
Thanks.
Julia.
Other folks?
Julia raised her hand.
Julia?
Hi, Cynthia. Yes, it's Julia Beattie, and I would like to follow on with both Senator Golden and as well Dave's comments. People's Bank has taken a very sincere interest in doing what we can to support the rebuild, and our focus is on housing. And Dave, to your point, on the immediate need, we have tried to provide some housing primarily through hotels for some displaced residents. That has proved to be a rather cumbersome effort. Our longer term interest, though, is not just this very immediate, what some people refer to as the triage need, but rather also that need for the 1 to 3 month and then even beyond until the rebuild can occur. And so along those lines, we're really pleased that People's Bank has made a significant financial commitment of over $1 million that we're going to fund through our foundation, the People's Bank of Commerce Foundation. Our employees are contributing to that as well. And with that, we are going to focus on the housing need primarily. And again, both in this very, very short, immediate period, but also with a longer term focus to see what we can do with the longer term construction needs of the Valley. And I guess one of my questions, Senator Golden, would be, we certainly don't want to spend these precious funds in ways that, in fact, there might be federal or state funding support. So I would be curious to know what you could share with regards to what those funds might look like and the timing of those funds and how we can complement then our contribution and use our contribution in the most efficient, effective way possible.
I think I'm going to slough that off to our federal delegation staff, Molly McCarthy and Senator Wyden's office, and Rep. Walden's very engaged. All three of our delegates are really engaged, and they are in constant or in steady conversation with FEMA about those questions. We think we're going to see funds soon. We're not clear on authority for dispersal of funds or the process or what exactly qualifies and doesn't. But I want to, I'm going to do my friends in the federal offices the favor of sending you to them because they actually might know what they're talking about.
Okay. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Julia. And thank you, People's Bank. That's awesome. That's it. Great start. Ilana, you had your hand up?
Yes. So I am the business librarian at Jackson County Library Services, and I want to let folks know that the library is a great hub for people to find information. So if you are offering housing opportunities for people, a lot of folks who have lost their homes are coming to the libraries for information, for temporary shelter, to stop and make decisions. So we are a great place to disperse that information. I'll put my email address in the chat, so I would love to help keep people updated. So we have 15 branches, and not all of them are open right now, but that's changing over time. We have an opportunity to keep people informed.
Thank you. Other folks? What have your businesses been, or what have you personally been involved in, and what needs are you seeing out there? Go ahead.
All right. This is Donna with Britt, and I just got out of a board meeting, and what we are going to be doing. Our musicians have approached us, and I'm talking about the orchestra musicians from all over the United States. They feel a real connection to this valley, and they want to do something. So our board of directors has decided to match whatever donations they contribute. And so we have no idea what the cap will be on that. But it's going to be a significant amount of money coming in. And the question that we had as a board is, where do we put this money? And of course, we've heard about the Rogue Credit Union and the fund that they've established. So my question really is for Ken Troutman. Is this, I got into this late because I was in the board meeting, but Ken, is there a way that we can somehow contribute to the funds that you guys have established? Is there going to be a vehicle for that?
Thank you, Donna. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
We've actually been talking about that. We formed a 501c3 foundation about 2 years ago. And there's some limitations on what can happen until they declare a disaster, which has happened. So now all of a sudden our foundation can be used for multiple purposes and still be considered a true donation. So the bank funds, as Julia said, will have $1 million that the bank's contributing. Our employees have selected to use their bonus availability up to 200,000, actually 215,000 that will go in. We have vendors that the bank uses nationwide that'll probably get us up to about $1.5 million. So we can take additional monies and put in, and then if there are restrictions on how that is used, our money, like Julia said, is going to be to figure out this housing issue in both short-term and long-term. the immediate emergency needs, the county's really stepped up. Everybody in the county's flooded the expo and every other place with all the things you need to handle if you've lost everything you own. So if you guys could tell us how you'd want it used, if you want to piggyback with us, you know, we can do that. Dave Wright and I were in a meeting with the county commissioners trying to figure out a long-term plan, and there are so many roadblocks. It's going to take a while. They're committed to trying to solve it also. It's going to take some state assistance just because we have a few state rules that are going to need to be bended to get around this as far as land use planning goes. So it's a long answer, but yeah, we can work with you. We can provide, you don't need a donation being a 501c3 already, but you need someone to make sure we're tracking the money.
You need someone to write a check to.
Yeah, and we can do that. And we're willing to do that.
Great, thanks. Dave Wilkerson, I saw your hand up there. I'm just assuming that's along the building lines. Unmute, need to unmute you.
Hi, Cynthia, thank you. Yes, we've been reaching out to our clients and just, you know, trying to figure out how we can be a design and construction and planning. And in fact, was speaking with Jason Elzey from the Housing Authority this afternoon about some, you know, just brainstorming some ideas of how can we make this better, and particularly for the long-term housing. As Ken mentioned, there are definitely some challenges to in terms of land use, you know, for both the county and the state level. I don't know if it's going to be possible or even desirable to put back, you know, what was there before. But certainly there's some opportunities to do things with you know, prefab housing, manufactured housing, you know, and one of the ideas I floated to Jason today was, you know, even doing panelized construction and putting folks to work in a makeshift assembly line, you know, building housing that they will eventually occupy, and getting all those components assembled so that they can be brought to the site once the land is cleared. And it doesn't solve the immediate housing need, and hopefully FEMA will step in there. But in terms of, you know, the permanent solution, the communities want these folks back. Everyone in the community wants these folks who are displaced to remain a part of the community. And I think finding this is an opportunity to really think big and, you know, not just replace what was lost, but to do something better that could maybe even be a model for other communities. And as Jason said today, you know, until COVID, nobody could figure out the remote work thing. It took a crisis for us to kind of get to the next level and figure out how do we solve that? And maybe this is the crisis that will propel us to solve the, you know, affordable, I mean, you know, truly affordable housing solution. And I know that, you know, the shipping containers are an idea. They're, you know, from our personal experience, there are, you know, there's some issues with those in terms of condensation and moisture control in our environment. And it may be that doing something that's along the lines of manufactured housing, but something that we do on the ground locally is, you know, is a way to put people to work and to reinvest those dollars back in the community.
Great, thanks. Gretchen or Alex, can't tell who from the...
It's Gretchen and Alex.
Both of you, excellent.
We're both here, although it looks like we're in witness protection. First of all, thanks to everybody. I think silver lining in all this is seeing this community come together in this really beautiful way. It's really been moving. I'm really happy to see the focus on affordable housing. I know a lot of you here. I run a digital marketing agency, MTO, in Ashland. I have been boots on the ground really early on. Fire happened on Tuesday. Wednesday, we put together Bike Brigade, and we're getting water into Talent on bikes. So we've been on the ground, hearing everything. I've been really using social media work to coordinate a lot of communication. What I'm seeing on the ground really is, number one, how much we need consolidation. There are way too many of everything right now, which, you know, on the first day we didn't have enough, and now there's a lot. And so I keep trying to find the ways which we can consolidate right now. It's one of the roles I'm playing. There's volunteer lists here, volunteer lists. I put the two people together that have those volunteer lists. can we work together, have one list between you two groups? Yes, I see another one, I keep doing that. So I'm trying to just kind of have, so right now where I'm trying to aim people to is the Rogue Volunteer Initiative, RVI. So we're working with the Bike Brigade people. We've got about 300 people, I think, on that list, trying to get them moved over to the RVI list and make sure all the needs are being funneled there. So I'd like to see consolidation wherever we can on the volunteer request front. And then there's the donation front as well. You know, it's scattered all over. We have right now a few different, like, create some, I have a friend that does relief efforts at a very high level in New Orleans. She's helped us figure out some things in a short term, like that we could get pallets of water delivered through Amazon that people could donate anywhere in the world, which lets them kind of one click give some stuff. We created a list very quickly. And now Michelle Glass with Rogue Action Network has connected. And I think she's, her new list, I was talking to her this morning, is getting directly from the distribution centers of the Walmart and the El Tapatio and Home Depot and the Expo Center where things are needed directly. Getting a lot of feedback. Whoa. Hello?
Someone have a question?
Oh, okay. So again, consolidation on the donations of the requests for people. So we're trying to funnel it to the right places and not competing for resources. So as much as we can consolidate there, I think another real point of consolidation and is Alana for the Jackson County libraries. Brilliant. I want to add you. I think we need to get lists together, like a master distribution list, so that we're getting out to everybody information. I know one of the big things that's needed right now that I don't think there's enough awareness around is mental health support at the expo right now. I know that a friend of mine who does trauma informed, like she's an educational therapist, has been going and helping to train the other counselors that are going how to deal with this level of issue because she's dealt with it. They need 10 people at a time at least. They're just walking around, seeing people in crisis, chatting with them and being able to just kind of help soothe people. I think there's a lot of the softer skill stuff that we need way more support on. People are absolutely traumatized. And, you know, one of the things that everybody here can, I think, really participate in, Jim, you know, you've been great today. And I want to give a shout out definitely to Steve Vincent at Avista. One of the things I'm hearing on the ground is that people are spending hours trying to get in touch with stuff like utilities and cable to make sure that money isn't automatically deducted from their bank accounts for auto payments of stuff that are spending hours trying to get through. This is the last thing any of these people need to be dealing with. And so if there's ways that we can preempt that and help get communication out. So Avista, just this is again, information dissemination. They're going to have a press release today. Hopefully it's in my inbox that we can distribute to help. They're automatically going to be stopping both the bill coming. And then also we talked about it and making sure that the auto payment thing, obviously there's so many low income of people affected. Those hundreds of dollars out of that bank account right now for no reason is really, really painful. So I think, you know, one of the things is I need to get in touch with someone like Dish Network, these sort of utilities. I reached out to Pam Marsh, who has been really, really, really amazing and responsive.
Hey, Gretchen, just so you know, Pam's on the call and we're going to ask her to talk in just a minute.
Okay, great. Well, shout out to Pam Marsh, who's been super, super awesome. So I did reach out trying to figure out if we can make sure that on the city side, that the any utilities that come from the city are automatically shut off the bills for anybody. And that the auto payment shut off. So I have a lot of feelers out there on the ground, happy to be able to relay message as much as I can, but again, consolidation of information as much as possible. So, you know, Cynthia, I think that this is a great forum that you've created. So if you could kind of, I think this group help with that, that's amazing. I will say we have some things to tackle when we get through this crisis a little bit further. The city needs, Ashland City, I don't know what other cities in our area, needs a comms officer. We had a really hard time getting communications out to people for a while. Pam Marsh has stepped into that void, really, really, really appreciative. I think it's settled a lot of nerves just getting the information about what's happening. And so as much as we can consolidate and share out to people, here's all the things that are happening, I think people are kind of starting to settle down a little bit.
I think you covered it wonderfully.
Great. All right, thanks. Thanks. So that's a great perspective too. And, you know, great work getting water into talent when they really needed it. Pam, it'd be great to hear from you. Jeff was kind enough to give us a tee up about what he knows about the long-term housing needs and would love to hear from you as well. Still there? You there, Pam?
Okay, that magic star six did it for me.
Excellent.
So I was a little late to the call, and I don't want to repeat things that were already said, because Jeff and I have been consulting together a lot as we go along. I mean, clearly, I think you all, you've, in terms of housing, you've really described it. We have the immediate crisis, which is really being handled by the Expo, largely. We're trying to consolidate services there, either daytime and or nighttime, although people are often sleeping in different locations, because it makes sense to try to have the physical services, the mental services, and those, totally agree, hearing about that, the need for that, and for children, a lot. The insurance counselors are out there, access is out there. It's been a little bit of a bumpy start, but I think it's getting in better shape, and I think the Expo is going to be with us for the foreseeable future. We, frankly, the people who are at the Expo now are those people who just can't figure out any place else to go. And I'm not sure what kind of social service support it's going to take to help them figure out where their next place is. And then there is the intermediary need for housing. We know that cleanup has to be approached in a comprehensive way, because it's, the area is full of toxics. Those dozen or more manufactured home parks and additional RV parks are largely pre-1980 homes, which means that they are full of asbestos. They're exuding toxins. And, you know, many of the other burned areas are going to be toxic as well. So cleanup is going to have to be approached in some sort of, in a comprehensive way. We're told that incident teams, either under FEMA or otherwise, will come in and help us figure that out. But it's going to be, I think it's going to be an out. I think if everything was a miracle, it has to be a year and a half out before there are new housing units in place. And those of you like David, who are on the ground all of this, you can verify that. But there's a long way to go before we can start building or even bringing in manufactured home units. So what we do for the next year and a half to 2 years to stabilize people is a whole set of questions that we're waiting for some direction from FEMA. And then we have a lot of great energy in the community jumping in and thinking about RV pods and different ways that we as a community could step up to house people. I would just add a postscript. I think, you know, by far the easiest way to house people is to make sure that the housing that we have on the ground is maximized. So house shares are really essential, making sure that every unit out there and every bedroom that's available is matched up. And that's a little tricky because people want to have some confidence in who's coming in. But we do get access to post at least a housing available, housing needed kind of match thing that might work for some people. And then we have to figure out a better way of really matching housing and vetting the people who will go into it. And then on the longer term, it's looking at the corridor as a whole, as a comprehensive whole, and really bringing together a planning and building and developing eye to that, that looks not just at the little piece that's in talent, not just the next little piece that's in the county, but that thinks comprehensively and creatively and inclusively and intentionally along that whole corridor. And many people are starting to think about that and were last week. So I agree with David. I think there's the potential, and Jason and the Housing Authority are just a tremendous asset for us. They are so talented. I think there's a fighting chance that we can get some really good affordable housing in there. So that's the big overview. I hope I didn't repeat too much that has already been stated.
Well, that's great. Thanks so much. Really appreciate it. Everybody has a slightly different facet of what they've seen and what they've been able to do so far. Hank, I saw that you had your hand up.
I think Colleen might be ahead of me.
Oh, thanks. Colleen.
Hello, everyone. Thank you. Just a quick shout out to People's Bank for doing what you're doing. Soberti has interfaced already with our EDA and our USDA partners, trying to figure out what new resources will come available, and that was reliant on the declaration of a disaster area. So I'm waiting for next steps. We had been working on some other things related to COVID, and I'm asking specifically whether some of those funds could also be morphed to respond to some of the fire needs also. I think what's important about what People's Bank and all of you are doing to help is the matching component that may be required by the federal government. So I have a lead that I'm going to be following up tomorrow with USDA. There seems to be some help that may be available for single family housing. And I know, as Representative Marsh said, that's a long-term thing, but that's an important critical factor. I will also say, just for your general knowledge, that our partners to the south in Reading, and I keep forgetting what their agency name is, but they reached out to us last week to share tips and pointers and best practices of how they emerged from the car fire or are continuing to rebuild after the car fire. So meeting is scheduled with our SBDC partners and Marta, who's on this call from Business Oregon, on Thursday. So rather than trying to reinvent something, we're going to learn what they were able to do and what we need to be aware of. So we are working on things right along with you, and we are very sorry for all the loss. Thank you.
Thank you, Colleen. And thanks for reminding us that there are people who've been through this nearby who we can learn from. That's super important. All right, Hank, did I leapfrog over anyone else?
I don't think so.
Okay.
Nice to see so many people concerned and willing to help. So nice to see you all. Barb Sibley, and my concern is the Hispanic population that in a lot of ways isn't plugged into a lot of our services. And our belief is a lot of those trailer homes were occupied by those families. And further, our belief is that a lot of those people keep their savings in their home because they don't completely trust the bank. So when you talk about losing everything, they truly do. And yet our belief is they're not going to the expo because they don't completely trust the system. And so I'm looking for ways to help access that group and help them to find services. So if anybody has advice today I was asked, call Mike Namas. He and Laura are doing a lot, so I'm going to try that tomorrow. But if there's other suggestions of how to get to that people, we've already talked to the county, and they've said it's a very delicate group because if they think it's not safe, they won't access the help. So anyway, it's a big concern for me. There's supposedly about 10,000 Hispanic people that are affected by this, and whether they're getting the same services as everyone, I don't believe they actually are.
Mm-hmm. So Camila, are you still on the call? Camila Thorndike, I think, she and I had a conversation earlier today, and she is working a lot with that. It looks like there's also some things in the chat that people could speak to. Camila, why don't you, if you're there, why don't you take it first, and then we'll hear from Julia and Talent Maker City.
Yeah, great. Thanks. My mom started and runs Lemaire Gardens in conjunction with Fry Family Farm, and I've been helping launch a campaign hosted by Our Family Farms, which is run by Elise Higley of Oshawa, out in the Applegate. And the purpose is to raise funds for housing solutions, ideally long-term, sustainable, awesome agricultural worker housing that could provide maybe even a model for the whole West Coast. So far, I believe we've raised over 20,000 was this morning, somewhere north of that. And I'll put the link in the chat. Ultimately, we hope to work in coalition and have been reaching out to UNETE and Northwest Seasonal Workers and others just to understand, first of all, a needs assessment has to be done of all the farms in the Our Family Farm Network. And it just so happens that the Fries and Lemaire four farm worker families lost their homes. So, you know, these are multi-generational families who don't have insurance or savings necessarily, and the Fries have been able to set up a couple very temporary units on the land, but we know there's a donation surge right now, and I think there's going to be a second wave of donor fatigue and sort of another crisis there, where if we're not thinking about the long term, we're going to be in a bad place. So I'm going to put the link in there and welcome any questions.
Great. Thanks, Camila. Let's see, who else was there? Julia, you wanted to speak about that?
Yeah, I just wanted to let you know, Hank, and everyone on the call, that the first need brought to the bank, very urgent need, was primarily the Hispanic community, those that are part of the Northwest Seasonal Workers. And we've had an opportunity to place about 55 of those families in some hotels, and I am in contact daily with the gentleman who is coordinating on their behalf the effort to get them connected with the services that they need. I also, though, wanted to mention, Hank, that I got a call today from the pastor of a church that is primarily a Hispanic church, and by my ability then to connect him with this other gentleman with Northwest Seasonal Farm Workers, there's an element of trust. So Hank, to your point, I think that the best way to reach out to the Hispanic community is in fact by doing so through contacts where there is a trust element. And so I'll be happy to assist you any way I can on that. Also as well, I am on the board of the Gordon Elwood Foundation, and we are very familiar with some organizations within the community that are geared towards supporting the Hispanic community, and I can also make connections that way as well.
Great, thank you. Martha, did you want to add to that conversation? I know you were in the chat.
Yes, I was researching the data points to a question Trevor Yarish asked earlier. 300 people, over 300 people are at the expo, according to a Kobe news segment a while ago. I do have a piece of information to share, as we just mentioned, that mid to long-term recovery should always be in the background of our thoughts as we go through the life and safety effort now and then immediate recovery later. Oregon Community Foundation, as well as My Memorial Trust and the Ford Family Foundation are starting, I want to say seeding, but it's going to be more than just a smaller seed fund. They are seeding a fund for that mid to long-term recovery. And we need to keep resources like that on our radar. And their goal is to leverage philanthropic as well as private sector donation flow for the best relief and recovery for the communities throughout Oregon. And we need to keep resources like that on our radar so that when amazing institutions like the People's Bank of Commerce step up and organize another effort, maybe there are ways in which we can leverage and access that funding later down the road, again, without, as somebody said earlier, competing for resources. I think there is a way, and there will be a way later, to leverage what's happening here on the ground to access larger resources.
Great, thanks so much. And it's really good to know that our foundations in Oregon are also stepping up with a longer range plan. Great. I see Ellen Holub's hand up. I don't know if anybody else's hand up that I'm leapfrogging over. Did I miss somebody? I think Ellen's been waiting to talk.
Hi, Cynthia. Yeah, can you hear me okay?
Yep, hear you great.
Hi guys, this is Ellen from Buttercloud Bakery. I'm so impressed with all the people who are here. Thank you guys. I just wanted to share a cool thing that I learned about today. We were asked to participate in a program called Rogue Food Unites. and it is in conjunction with the World Central Kitchen, and Jose Andres is come to the Valley with his relief efforts. So it sounds pretty cool. Basically, through the nonprofit support, they essentially buy, food through local restaurants that then gets dispersed to those people in need. So if anybody out there knows of another restaurant or somebody who would like to participate in this, it's a cool program. And I'm sure the more, people we have participating, the better. So that's something that maybe we could look into, or you could, message me and I can probably get the information for you how to participate in that.
Great, thanks. And I think that's what Lindsay Berryman just sent a document to us with that outlined that program as well. So I have a PDF of a document that explains what is going on with that program if anybody needs it. Okay, let's see. Trevor, I know you have things up your sleeve and you haven't spoken yet. Do you want to talk about the app you're working on?
Sure. Hello, everybody. Again, my hat's off to so many people. People's Bank, thank you so much for stepping up in such a huge way. It just warms my heart just to think about how much so many people right now are giving of themselves and to help other people they don't necessarily know. It's pretty amazing. Jim Tease actually had inspired an app to just help connect people with things. And I know that there's a lot of hubs right now collecting things for people, but something that could serve a little bit more long-term. So as these, in an initial disaster scenario that like we have experienced, we were lacking in some tooling. And I think everybody felt that. And so to create something to help bridge that gap and have some tools right away that we can utilize, some technology tools that help connect people with resources, like tangible physical resources. And so working with Jim on that, and but at the end of the day, one of the things that I've been working on is there's the emotional side, right? So there's the physical side that's really hard. People have been talking about it, the actual structures and the toxic materials and all that has to go into just making the place livable again, and how long we're really looking at here. And so there's the other side of it, which is the mental health of so many people, and so have been working with a venue that is a little bit defunct right now because of COVID, but we've been producing live stream shows. And one of the things that we've been doing is creating some fundraiser opportunities there, but just the idea of creating some remote style concerts for the people who are displaced and remain displaced. So, I mean, right now, if I was displaced from my home, I would have a number of places to go. So the idea that a week out, someone still doesn't have a place to go but the expo breaks my heart. And so in that scenario, that's basic necessity. That's shelter, water, food that you are able to access, but there's no entertainment. I know that there's so much, I hate to say it, but distraction that's needed, and feeling of care, warmth, people interacting. And it's really hard right now because if you are personally interacting, there's masks involved. So you can't even have that physical, emotional connection that we are all used to having. So just really brainstorming and working on ways to contribute in, that this is going to be a long haul, and it's not just the fire, it's a unique situation with COVID making it even harder for us to deal with this. And so working to try and come up with ideas and work with whether it's musicians or there's some I don't want to mention any names right now because I don't want to put them on the spot, but some companies that deal in things like crafting and things like that, painting, that are starting to come together and working to create opportunities to go out and just bring some life into the scenario for the people who don't have family or friends to connect with right now, that are sort of just depending on each other and staff. I mean, I know there's a lot of people that are helping, but it's just hard to imagine, hard to fathom. So that's one of the things that I've been working on through one of my companies. And I'll stop rambling at that.
Great. Yeah. Anything that can infuse some humanity and some sense of normalcy back into people's lives would be great. Also, there is a site, roguevalleyrecovers.org, that does match volunteers with services needed and items needed with items that people want to donate. So I'll put that in the chat. That's roguevalleyrecovers.org. Ryan at Talent Maker City, I saw your hand up.
Yeah, I was going to comment on engaging the Latinx community. Talent Maker City, along with Rogue Action Center and Rogue Climate, who are Northwest field work, farm worker, whatever that is. We've been doing it here. We have translators, Spanish translators on site. We've every night been delivering hot meals to the affected, those housing units that are still standing, those that aren't, but the people are still displaced. So we have a real good idea of what needs are, and we are also one of those trusted entities, as was mentioned, and that is incredibly important to be of the people, not just, you know, putting out your hand. So just so everybody knows, we've been doing the aid station for Talent in Phoenix pretty much families who have lost everything, tents, all that. So if there is a need to engage, or if any of you or your businesses are looking for a way to engage, especially with the Latinx community, then we might be a good resource to do that. We also list all of our resources. Most of them, I'm still getting translations in English and Spanish on our website, which not a lot of people do. And that's step one in saying, hey, we care. So Talent Maker City is a resource. We're available for questions like that, or can facilitate in a lot of cases. So just wanted to throw that out there.
Great, thanks. And so do you have regular volunteer opportunities? Is there a place to sign up if you want to come volunteer there? So
yeah, we have a big info board right outside. So half our parking lot is a big support station with water, food, essentials, tents, sleeping bags, everything. In addition to all the resources we now offer, we have a Wi-Fi hotspot. A lot of people, as Trevor was mentioning the mental health element, just don't have a way to get connected. With the broadband hotspot now up, that's a huge step and a huge resource for people to connect with each other and to better understand what resources are available, where to go, that type of thing. We have a giant information board. People can come in and put their name on 2-hour shifts. And that's mostly interfacing with affected people, getting them what they need, whether it's toothpaste or water or ice, that type of thing. Abundant ways to volunteer. They can either email me, ryan@talentmakercity.org, or just come down and see what's going on, so you can appreciate the magnitude of the displacement, the affected families. It's incredibly powerful just to talk to a lot of these people and hear what they're going through, because it's not just my house burned down. It's I don't know what to do. I don't know how to do. I don't know any of this stuff. So yeah, to answer your question, myriad ways to volunteer. Just let me know or come on down, put your name on the board.
Great, thanks. And does anybody who has been, you know, in the sort of triage mode, I mean, maybe there aren't peak hours for things, but I don't know whether people are, you know, giving people release time from work to go volunteer at these places or not. I was at OSF for an evening shift, and there were very, very few people there. It was later on, it wasn't early on, but, you know, if there are peak hours, it would be helpful for those of you who have run distribution centers or been volunteering at them to let us know, you know, when, what times are times that most people show up and you need the most help. You could just put that in the chat. Other folks who want to weigh in and chime in on what you're up to? Yeah, Hank, I wasn't sure if that was an old hand raise or a new hand raise.
No one. Three quick topics. Matthew Bernard at Derek's is really focused on helping. So Derek's is going to be donating 25% of our revenue from our website sales for the next couple months to the United Way. We figure it's going to be about $50,000. I just say that as a way to say, give other people ideas of how they might get involved in this. We also have this building that most of us are working from home. And so Sunday afternoons might be joining us with some of their staff that got displaced with their lost building. But we have the ability to have, we have desks, we have Wi-Fi, we have bathrooms, we're fully COVID compliant, I'll tell you that. But if you know businesses that go, I need a place to go on a day, then they might want to try to get a hold of us and say, you know, could I find a desk in there? Because that's going to go for, at some level, we need to keep our businesses going so that we have incomes.
Yeah.
And the final thing is, I figured this out just a couple days ago, but with Zoom, you don't have to find the microphone to unmute. You can just push the space bar. It's the greatest simple thing. So I don't have to look for that damn microphone. So that's all for me.
Great, great. Like how to survive on Zoom plus, designate a certain percent of your revenue to United Way or to another organization that's rebuilding. And it sounds like you've got kind of a co-working space offer there too for anybody who needs Wi-Fi and a desk. There may be a lot of places like that here because a lot of people can't work without that. And I know Jim's been hopping around the valley putting up hotspots for folks so that they can get access. Jim, you wanna talk about what you've been engaged in? Oh, I'm sorry, there's two more hands up and I missed them. Tiffany, did you, were you before David?
No idea.
Okay, well, why don't you go ahead and the David will come right back to you.
okay, so my name's Tiffany. We have a furniture store in downtown Medford, Tiffany's at Home. And what we're doing, and this is, it will apply to any organization that is providing housing or materials or anything to fire victims directly or the fire victims themselves as they get to points where they need to refurnish or, you know, bedding and mattresses. And we're going to be offering things for those groups of people at cost. So that need's going to change. We did the same thing with the Paradise Fire. There's a lot less I think we're gonna be busier this time than we were with Paradise because we were out of the way of Paradise. But we've already had a few people come get mattresses and stuff. So right now I think the need's gonna be more pillows, sheets, mattresses, things of that nature. And then as people get rehoused and rehomed, then that's when the furniture piece is going to you know, take place. I've not really put any time restrictions on this. For me, it's more of a need basis. These people have lost everything. You know, we have to find some way to help. So we're doing that for the fire victims. And again, for any establishment that is aiding fire victims. We're for people that are normally gonna go buy furniture anyway and need something for furniture, mattresses, that are buying it at regular price. We're also setting $15 for every $100 spent. We're going to set that aside in a fund, and that money will be donated depending on need, depending on how that money builds up, and then need, we'll figure out where the, you know, best use of those funds are. Just a warning, especially to the people that are doing multifamily setups. Furniture and mattresses are in, the supply chain has been ravished by COVID. It is not good right now. So it is something that, even though I know that everybody's kind of in reaction mode, trying to deal with immediate need, it's not going to be the easiest things getting your hands on stuff immediately. So it is something that I would encourage, whether it's through my store or any other place in the Valley or online even, to try to plan for, because the supply chain for both of those industries is, things are taking a really long time to get our hands on. So just a, you know, kind of warning on top of everything else.
Great, thanks for letting us know. And Tiffany, your store is Tiffany at Home, is that right?
Tiffany's at Home, yeah, we're on East Main Street in Medford.
Great, thank you. Thank you, and thanks for your generosity. And David?
Thank you, Cynthia. Hank reminded me that I wanted to share with you all, ORW has a co-work space in downtown Medford that was really intended more for the design community. We have several interior designers on the second floor of the building, and we actually have a vacancy in that space at the beginning of October, and wanted to just throw that out there, really not knowing how to make the offer to folks who need it, but anyone who needs just, you know, a hoteling space, you know, onesie, twosie workstations with front office support, you know, free Wi-Fi, printer and plotter capabilities. You know, just, we can't really accommodate anyone on the fabrication or manufacturing side, which I know is a lot of what the businesses and talent in Medford, talent in Phoenix were lost, but anyone who just needs office space to work, we have that available.
Great, thanks. Thanks. I'm sorry, did I just cut somebody off? Okay, great. Jim, you wanna let us know what you're up to?
I'm up to here in appreciation for all of you and everything that you're doing. So my job, as I saw it, as this happened, was to support, run around and support as many of you doing what you're doing. And that's what we're doing. So when I hear that somebody has electricity in a parking lot and they want to set up a hotspot in their community, which is what Talent Maker City did, then that's what I do. When I hear from a church that says, we'll put a hotspot in our parking lot and it's, you know, for anybody to come by so they can do their insurance claims, that's what I do. When all the fire people that moved in at the expo, they just set up camp, and they, you know, all these kids now, when they're on break from fire duty, they need hotspots, they need internet. So that's what we do. And the unfortunate thing, I know we're focused on here, super hyper focused on here, but it's everywhere. The fires and fire camps and all of that. So we've got major equipment shortages. I just yesterday spent way too much money on shipping. Really, it was like one of those things where I was like, really, I'm going to spend $900 on shipping? But we did it. You know, that was just me being cheap. And we got all the equipment in this morning, and my team from Roseburg came down here, and we installed wherever we could. And then I'm sending my team with the Roseburg team back to Roseburg, because they're in fire camp situations there. And so we're just here to support and do everything that we can. Very proud of People's Bank. That was a unanimous decision by the board yesterday. So that's all I'm doing.
Great, thank you. Yes, our lifeline these days. Anyone else want to share, ask or offers or ask questions of anybody else who shared what they're doing? Oh, okay, great.
Can I add one more thing real quick? I'm sorry, Trevor, go ahead.
Oh, actually, I was just gonna ask if maybe you would share your creative inventive idea for the RV park you created.
Oh, thanks. So I know the Hispanic thing is at top of mind for all of us. Dina and I, a couple of years ago, adopted a local family And through them, we outreached to others. And the way that we thought we could solve this until the big machine can solve it for everybody is individually adopt as many families as we could. And so so we did that, and we found out the way they house and the way we think about tiny homes and the way we think about, you know, the millennials, they like to go eat out every meal. These families are wired completely different. And so, you know, we're working really hard to house them. And Project 8, again, the COVID thing was all of my employees now work from home. So our office is empty and our parking lot is completely empty. And I didn't want to turn it into an RV park necessarily, but I did go through the channels at the county. There is a process, and they're on a Saturday at 10 a.m. I got approval, and we're going to build basically a makeshift RV camp. But it isn't, I was dumb when I first went through this. I thought it was just me a couple weeks. It's not a couple weeks. Ken straightened me out. This is going to be a year plus. So anything we do has to be long term. And I know there's trust issues with the communities and all of that, but if we go through our friends, they'll trust our friends. They'll, you know, we need to help. We can't just give up because of trust issues. We've got to figure out a way to do it. So that's what we're doing. And it's all legal and on the up and up. The county was very supportive and happy to give us the permits required. They want to house as many people as possible. And they asked, can we put more in there? And I'm like, well, let me take care of these two families first. And what's amazing is the more you learn, there is a language barrier. And I did not pay enough attention in high school in Spanish class. But what's amazing is that their husbands, I've got two women, three children each in RVs. I'm trying to get another RV. Their husbands are out fighting our fires. So this is all crazy, fluid, emergency, scary times for them. And so, you know, we're just doing what we can to help.
Great. Did you see that? Colleen speaks Spanish and is willing to help wherever she can in the chat. Awesome. All of you who are so fortunate and talented and gifted as to be able to speak more than one language, this is a wonderful offer to help out.
Cynthia,
Yep, Pam?
This is Pam. I just wanted to with this crowd that has so many connections, I wanted to mention one slightly non-wildfire, but very much housing-specific thing, which is in the background, we've all forgotten that we have COVID and an eviction moratorium. But now it is more important than ever that people who have their homes don't lose their homes. So if you all could help us reach out to anyone that you know who's a neighbor or who is unable to pay rent and mortgage right now because there is help for that, they can go to Access or to in Ashland, the options for helping residents of Ashland, and they can get help with many months of rent. And there's some options there for mortgages as well. So I just really trying to get the word out, because what we don't want is people to fall through the cracks and to make the housing situation even more of a crisis if it can be such a thing. So please encourage those people that you're running into to get help with housing. And if anybody wants specific information, let me know.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. Yep.
Jim? Can I offer one more thing? I encourage you all, if you're on Facebook, to share the stories of what you're doing, not just the links to the resources and everything else, but share what you're doing. And the reason this is important is because people need to know that there is a solution, that we're working on it, that it's, you know, it's not perfect and we've never gone through this before. So, but I've started writing immediately as this started happening, and people love it. My stories are way too long, but they love it. They love it only because it helps them believe people are doing something. So I encourage all of you to go do that.
I was just going to say one more thing, Pam, just to piggyback on that. We have started to see funds for residents come in for our, from Access and United Way to help pay off some of these balances. So that's good to see, and it's really helpful. So just to piggyback on her comment, let's get the word out that those people need help.
There is also some mortgage assistance that was just released by the state so that people could actually pay their mortgages rather than defer them. But there's not a lot, so people need to jump on it right away.
Great, good to know. Okay, so there is so much going on here and so much activity. I hope people started to put pieces together so that we can, you know, do what Gretchen said, and that is consolidate a little more, not duplicate our efforts as much, and so that we can direct people to resources or help where, you know, where it's needed. Special thanks to Senator Golden, Representative Marsh, that just super helpful to have you guys on the call. Did you want to say something, Jeff?
Yes, please. Yes. I just think Jim just made a fantastic point in terms of what people are looking for out there. And I heard 30 stories in the last 45 minutes that people are going to take comfort and inspiration from. So that's a great idea. What are you doing? And what are you seeing being done around you? This call lifted me. Thank you. I just now got an update bulletin from the Mail Tribune that said the lost residence count is now at 2350.
And that's structures, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, many of those are
multifamily. Well, residences. Residential
units.
Residential units, and many of those are obviously not single people. It's amazing.
Yeah. Wow. Well, I'm going to steal a line from you then, Jeff, and everybody do what you can do. We'll coordinate as we can. We've gotten great communication from Jeff and Pam, both with lots of resources. I have recorded this call and I will save the chat. Thank you, Alana, for reminding me. I sometimes forget. And so that's a resource as well. And so if you know somebody who would like, you know, this a link to this file, let me know. And I think everybody has our email addresses by now. Please join the Southern Oregon E2E, two is the number, E2E Facebook page. You'll get to see Jim's stories there, for one, which are very entertaining and heartwarming, and hopefully stories from everybody else here too. I really think it's a great idea to let people know what you're doing. You know, share your creative ideas, let people know if you've got a guest house or a trailer, or, you know, have other ideas, and that would just be great. So thank you all for your time and all the work you're putting into this in the early stages. I know we will meet and compare notes again. Jim, anything else you wanted to add? No, we good? All right, be safe, everybody out there. Pray for rain.
Bye.
Thank you, Cynthia, for putting this together.